Yellowstone. Welcome to the world's first national park, Yellowstone. The golden rocks, effervescent waters, teeming forests, meadows and streams of Yellowstone have been duly christened by the United Nations as a World Biosphere Reserve and as a World Heritage Site. This is North America's Serengeti, where 1,700 kinds of plants sustain 60 mammal and 311 bird species. Here, 150 lakes and 500 streams give birth to the mighty rivers and thrive with 24 species of fish. The generally placid flow of these watercourses is spectacularly interrupted by nearly 300 waterfalls. Like inverted waterfalls, Yellowstone's 300 geysers erupt skyward, flying in the face of the old adage and arguing instead that what goes down must also come up. Less flashy, but equally intriguing, are the geysers' cousins, hot springs, fumaroles, mud pots, and travertine terraces. These geothermal features are variations on the physics of boiling water, are 10,000 in number, comprise half of the planet's total population of geothermal features, and yet are concentrated in the 2.2 million acre square in the upper left corner of Wyoming's map, simply labeled Yellowstone. Here, tourism became a science. Here, the U.S. Army defeated extinction by protecting the last of the bison. Here, big government and big business united to preserve something greater than the revenue it generated. Here, preservation became an ethic. Yellowstone is the example touted to help justify the establishment and protection of 3,600 other national parks in 143 different countries. It's an adventurer's dream, meticulously planned. It's the first and last word of the favorite vacation story. It's where many first fall in love with the outdoors, with geology, with wildlife, with history, and with photography. It's also where you can fall in love with all those same things for all the same reasons, plus many more. It's the every park for everyone. Welcome to Yellowstone. Yellowstone Lake covers 136 square miles and reaches a depth of 390 feet, making it North America's largest lake above 7,000 feet. This lake fills the bottom of a supervolcano's caldera. Geologists calculate that in 600,000-year intervals, a series of three horrific volcanic eruptions blasted out enough lava, rock, and ash from the Yellowstone region to fill Arizona's entire Grand Canyon. The smallest and most recent eruption left a smoldering crater 30 by 45 miles across 640,000 years ago. The continual heat from this dormant but not extinct mega volcano still powers the park's 10,000 geothermal features. The subsequent erosion by rivers and glaciers makes it hard to identify the caldera's rim. Yet, from Lake Butte Overlook, while studying the purple dotted boundary on your park brochure, you can trace the circumference of this ancient crater. The whole lake basin itself is unstable. Lake sediments always form flat deposits. However, the layers in Yellowstone Lake slope southward, suggesting that since they were deposited, the north end of the basin has been rising. Indeed, between 1923 and 1985, the North Shore rose by a documented 2.5 feet. Since 1987, the North Shore has been sinking. Only a restless supervolcano could make an entire lake slosh back and forth. As you stroll the beaches or boat the waters of this lake, try not to dwell on the fact that you are at ground zero of a potential re-eruption. Geologists promise there should be plenty of early warning signs many years before any re-eruption. Thank you. The Yellowstone River is the longest undammed river in the United States. Along its 671-mile length, no segment has greater contrasts than the 5-mile stretch between Hayden Valley and the Grand Canyon of the Yellowstone. Like Yellowstone itself, this river has a surprise around every bend. In Hayden Valley, the river is so broad and placid that American white pelicans fish it as if it were a lake. Any fish or pelican that swims downstream from Hayden Valley will soon be in for the ride of its life. Riffles become rapids, and rapids give way to upper falls, a 109-foot plunge into the Grand Canyon of the Yellowstone. Hayden Valley is a wildlife mecca. Indeed, as you view down into the wide expanse of this former glacial lake valley, you may see not only cloud shadows, but herds of bison drifting across the verdant green knolls in the summer. If traffic grinds to a halt, assume that a large herd of these 2,000-pound animals is crossing the road. As docile as these lumbering beasts appear, it's wise to stay in your car. Bison kill and injure more tourists than all other Yellowstone animals put together. They can sprint 30 miles per hour and easily dispatch their adversaries by trampling or goring. Keep at least 100 feet from all bison, especially baby bison found nestled in the mountain meadow flowers near a protective parent, or scampering to keep up with their ponderous guardian. You may also see male bison vying for the rights to the best mud rolling spot as they try to shed their shaggy winter coats.
In Yellowstone National Park, bison are one of the big draws. But get too close and they can be dangerous, especially the males. A tourist at Old Faithful doesn't realize the risk. He walks up to a bison and pays the price. It's an attack Lou Ann Freer knows well. Her medical team treated the victim.
He had been gored in the back of the leg, which is classic. Our victims who are gored by bison almost always have their wounds from the thigh up to the back, and it's because they're always running away.
The man survived, but was left with some nasty scars to remind him of the attack. A bison's hooves and horns are a lethal threat.
The Old Faithful Inn is located in Yellowstone National Park. It was first opened in 1904 and is located with a clear view and within a few football fields of the renowned Old Faithful Geyser. The inn features a multi-story log lobby, flanked by long frame wings containing guest rooms. With its spectacular log and lip lobby, and massive 85-foot-tall stone fireplace, the inn presents itself as a rustic resort that is not only unique in its architecture here in America but also in the entire world. It is the first of the Great Park Lodges of the American West. Initially constructed over the winter of 1903 to 1904, it is famous for its efforts to conform to the wilderness around it. Locally obtained materials were used, including lodge pole pine and rhyolite stone. It is believed to be the largest log hotel in the world. In 2007, it was ranked 36th in a survey to determine America's favorite 150 buildings. When it first opened, it could boast of electric lights and steam heat. The original cost of the inn was about $140,000, using materials gathered from within the park. It was furnished for another $25,000. Most of the logs used came from 8 miles south of Old Faithful. Stone came from the Black Sand Basin and Crane Pass about 5 miles to the east. The unusually shaped log brackets were collected from the surrounding forests. The inn has been expanded and modified many times. In 1913, the east wing was added to the 120-room original structure. In 1922, the dining room was enlarged. In 1928, the west wing was built and the front of the main building extended. All of these modifications were carried out under the supervision of the original architect, Robert Reamer. In 1936, the first bear pit featuring carved and inlaid wood panels was built just off the lobby. An automatic fire sprinkler system was added in 1948. Some of the original furnishings remain, while care has been taken with newer pieces to remain compatible with the rustic design. In celebration of the centennial in 2004, a major multi-million dollar renovation project of the original old house started with completion in 2008. The building now has a complete infrastructure upgrade including new electrical, plumbing, and heating systems as well as major structural upgrades. Great care and sensitivity was undertaken to integrate systems and restore and install original and new finishes to maintain the appearance and layout of the inn during the period immediately after it opened its doors in 1904. The Lake Hotel was built to accommodate visitors to Yellowstone National Park in 1891. It was redesigned in 1903 and substantially expanded by Robert Reamer, the architect of the Old Faithful Inn. In contrast to the Old Faithful Inn, the Lake Hotel is a relatively plain clapboard colonial revival structure with two large Ionic porticos facing Yellowstone Lake. The original hotel was a large three-story structure with projecting bays at each end. Reamer's 1903 remodeling changed these projections to the present Ionic porticos. An eastward extension was added at this time, with a third matching portico. In 1923, the further extension to the east was undertaken. In 1928, the two-story west wing was added. The dining room was expanded and a solarium added to the front of the hotel. The entire facility was extensively renovated from 1984 to 1990. The west wing was renovated in 2012, including the formal dining room and beautiful sunroom and lounge. The remaining rooms in the east end have been done and were completed in June 2014. Hotel guest rooms capture the historic ambience, while an adjacent annex and nearby cabins provide more basic and economical overnight accommodations. The main building has classic white columns accenting the yellow exterior. It creates a vision that makes it stand out and apart from the surrounding forest and meadows. A trip to Yellowstone with an intended overnight stay should not be undertaken without first making sure you have a reservation. I made the mistake of not making a reservation. That decision resulted in serious consequences. I ended up driving nearly 100 miles east, at night, in mountains where I could hardly see what might be drop-offs on the side of the road, and made what could be a 2-hour trip in the daytime a nearly 4-hour nighttime excursion. And all performed driving in the wrong direction. You see from the map being shown that a visit to Yellowstone is basically performed by visiting sites that are within the red circle. The map also shows a great many red markers spread widely that indicate hotel or motel accommodations. However, you will also observe there are no red markers within the red circle. In fact, those red markers will always be 50 to 100 miles away from wherever it is that you are within Yellowstone. There are 9 exceptions. Within the red circle, and along the eastern and southern loop of the highway, are the Old Faithful Inn, Old Faithful Cabins, and the newer Old Faithful Snow Lodge, the Lake Hotel and Lake Hotel Cabins, the Grant Village Lodge, and the Canyon Lodge and Cabins at the Upper Falls. They are indicated with arrows pointing to their location. And 8 is the Mammoth Hot Springs Hotel, just 5 miles south of the north entrance to the park. The last is the Roosevelt Lodge Cabins. They are located between Mammoth and the northeast entrance to the park. On my first day in the park, I found myself late in the afternoon along the Yellowstone River just north of Yellowstone Lake. There was significant buffalo activity, many swimming across the river, which is neither wide nor swift at that point. A few miles further north and they would be candidates for a bad ride towards the upper and lower falls. It was at this juncture I decided I needed to locate accommodations, and there might also be many others trying to do the same thing. It was a good idea to start looking, a bad idea not to have a room booked already. I had no fear based on the size of the Lake Hotel that I would in fact get a room. That was not the case, as they were fully booked, as was the case when they called over to inquiry of the availability of rooms at the Old Faithful Inn and Grant Village. I didn't have a map with me that shows all the little red markers, and I had no idea I was most likely 75 to 100 miles away from that evening's bed. My GPS did have a list of motels, however, and miles to drive. I boiled my decision down to driving south past the Grand Tetons to Jackson Hole, which would have been like 75 miles, and I intended to visit the Teton the next day. That was the smart choice. However, the GPS indicated a closer unit to the east just beyond the entrance gate. That would work great, as it would then provide me an opportunity to deal with the eastern approach to Yellowstone before I headed out the south entrance towards the Grand Tetons. I headed east but was never able to find the place the GPS had flagged. I should have turned around and headed back but didn't. I kept going east, and civilization did not reappear until I went through the tunnel west of Cody and from there downhill to a lovely little town. I quickly found one of the loveliest Best Western premium motels I have stayed in, and that was almost worth the drive. The next night I was in Jackson Hole following my visit to the Grand Tetons, and that Best Western was equally nice. What follows is a map of the drive from Cody, Wyoming to the Yellowstone south entrance, and thereafter a few photos that were taken in the early morning hours on the return trip to Yellowstone's east entrance.
Thank you.
Lewis Falls is a 30-foot-high drop of the Lewis River about a mile downstream from Lewis Lake. It is located 11 miles north of Yellowstone's south entrance. Due to its location near and above a highway bridge crossing of the Lewis River, it is one of Yellowstone's most photographed waterfalls. It is easily seen from one's car window when driving the south entrance road. However, there is a pull-out and parking area nearby. Many visitors merely pull off the road on either side of the bridge and take photos. The falls are accessible by use of the uphill Lewis Falls Trail. It is an easily accessible path which leads to a dramatic overlook of the Lewis River and a view from above the falls itself. In recent years, more than 700,000 visitors passed through the south entrance gates, and many of those visitors stop to walk the trail. On the way from the south entrance gates, visitors are treated to some Grand Canyon-type landscape with the Lewis River below. Soon, however, the highlands through which the river has carved its way come down from their high levels and become one with the river itself. At this point, one comes to the bridge crossing, and stunningly on the left, so nearby the road, are the Lewis Falls etched into the surrounding landscape. Biscuit Basin Loop offers a 2/3 of a mile lollipop loop hike in Yellowstone National Park's Upper Geyser Basin. Even though the boardwalk is short, there are plenty of hydrothermal features to see. Highlights include colorful hot springs and spurting geysers like Black Opal Pool, Sapphire Pool, Jewel Geyser, Shell Spring, Cavicat Spring, Mustard Spring, and Black Pearl Geyser. Biscuit Basin is only a few miles north of Old Faithful Village on the Grand Loop Road. A 1/4-mile boardwalk will guide you through Biscuit Basin, which got its name from the biscuit-like deposits that once surrounded the bright blue water of Sapphire Pool. The geothermal areas of Yellowstone include several geyser basins as well as other geothermal features such as hot springs, mud pots, and fumaroles. The number of thermal features in Yellowstone is estimated at 10,000. The study that was completed in 2011 determined there are a total of 1,283 geysers which have erupted in the park, 465 of which are active during an average year. These are distributed among 9 geyser basins, with a few geysers found in smaller thermal areas throughout the park. Although famous large geysers like Old Faithful are part of the total, most of Yellowstone's geysers are small, erupting to only a foot or two. The hydrothermal system that supplies the geysers with hot water sits within an ancient active caldera.
There's an old saying about nature that the only constant is change. There are not many places where that is more true than here at Biscuit Basin. The basin was named for the center deposits that were in some of the hot springs prior to the Hebgen Lake earthquake in 1959. One of those hot springs, Sapphire Pool, was famous for biscuit-shaped deposits and clear blue water. Immediately following the earthquake, Sapphire Pool's water clouded up and began to boil. Weeks later, Sapphire started having powerful geyser eruptions that broke any remaining biscuits away. It wasn't until 1971 that the water in Sapphire Pool cleared. Today, Jewel Geyser is the most regular geyser in the basin. With frequent small eruptions that come every few minutes, occasionally Jewel can have bursts of 40 feet or more. The ever-changing thermal activity reaches well beyond the basin. The changing features cause the amount and direction of the thermal runoff to change. When this silica-laden water flows into forested patches, it kills the trees. Called Bobby Sox trees for their white bases, these trees take decades to decay. Most years, rangers from the Old Faithful Visitor Center lead hikes to Mystic Falls that begin right here at the bridge leading into the basin. This 2-mile round-trip hike weaves its way through a forest that burned in 1988. It is possible to find at least 5 different tree species that have begun to reestablish themselves between the basin and the falls. This is Black Diamond Pool behind me. In 2006, a series of powerful eruptions occurred here. The only certainty pertaining to Biscuit Basin is it will continue to change. Spend some time here and you might be amazed at the changes you notice from one visit to the next.
time, but driving in an erratic manner.
One of my last experiences in Yellowstone occurred about 5 miles before I left the park at the north entrance and Roosevelt Arch. It involved my few hour stay in a very small one-road community named Mammoth Hot Springs. The town sits adjacent to one of the park's wonders. It is a fairly large area that over time built up tier upon tier of cascading terraced stone. It is a wonder and cars are allowed to drive through unmarked paths. I photographed much of the area and then entered the town for an afternoon bite to eat. After a nice meal, I returned to my car and began my drive out of town. I had hardly driven the block when it dawned on me that I seemed to be in the center of a disturbance. It seemed like out of nowhere a crowd of people had gathered in different stops, and I immediately sensed I might be surrounded by a security or police type activity, and my heart seemed to jump into my throat. My first thought was to question myself as to what had I done that was a violation. Then out of nowhere the very large elk ran past the left side of my car. I was being urged by official to get myself out of the area immediately. I parked up the street out of harm's way. I then walked back to see what this was all about. To make the story short, it is nothing more than the male elk assembling the leftovers so he could have his own harem. One of the park rangers explained to me that he had actually been in a duel with another elk the previous day and had lost, and this was his follow-up efforts to gather the ladies he could find. What follows in photos hardly does justice to what took place in the short period I tried to capture, not the beauty of some of these animals. It does, however, give you a chance to see such an activity as it occurred. Driving out of town, I was treated to numerous groups of elks that had assembled a small herd, and they grazed peacefully on some very steep and hilly terrain in that general area. The bottom line is there is danger for people who are too close or get between the elk and the females. So a security force and park rangers are on hand to assure visitors understand and maintain their distance from the activity. My pictures are thus taken at a distance, and it is the camera's zoom lens that gets close and not me.
Thank you.
There are a lot of must-see attractions in Yellowstone National Park, but you should not leave the park without visiting Mammoth Hot Springs. This impressive hydrothermal area may not have any high-spouting geysers, but it does have one of the world's greatest collections of hot springs with terraces made up of travertine deposits. The colorful steps and pools look more like something you would see in a cave next to stalactites than anything you are used to seeing above ground. This is an active hydrothermal area, which means that the terraces and pools are constantly growing and changing. These living sculptures can be seen on foot over a series of boardwalks as well as up your car window on Upper Terrace Drive. It takes a little over an hour to hike through the main and lower terraces. The boardwalks cover about 1.75 miles with 300 feet of elevation change. Along the way, you'll see notable features like Canary Spring, Minerva Terrace, Pallet Spring, and Liberty Cap. The walkways can be accessed from a parking area on Upper Terrace Drive next to the main terrace or from a parking area below the lower terraces by Liberty Cap, the dormant hot spring cone. Upper Terrace Drive is a 1.5 mile one-way loop that can be explored in your car or on foot. The paved circuit passes interesting features like Orange Spring Mound, White Elephant Back Terrace, and Angel Terrace. Just past the start of Upper Terrace Drive, there is a large parking area. Pull over and get out here to walk amongst the terraces on park-provided boardwalks. Thermophiles, microorganisms that love heat, are responsible for the rich color of grassy spring and other hydrothermal features in Yellowstone. Yellow marks extremely hot water, while greens and blues typically mark pools cooler than 140 degrees Fahrenheit. The step-like terraces form as heated water moves along the Morris Mammoth Fault. The hot water carries dissolved calcium and bicarbonate to the surface of the terraces where pressure lessens. Carbon dioxide then escapes as gas and the carbonate combines with calcium to precipitate as travertine. The mammoth terraces are constantly changing shape and color. Springs which were active 1 to 5 years ago may be dry and lifeless now, yet activity may later resume. Along with changes of thermal activity come changes in color. Fresh travertine is bright white in color and as it weathers it changes to gray. Bright colored cyanobacteria and algae mats which were dependent upon a stable temperature and a flow of water also change as the microorganisms die, creating a stark, bleak landscape.